3, 2, 1.
Hello and welcome to Rugby League Fanfare, brought to you by the International Rugby League Supporters Federation. My name's Rob Corra. I'm your host for this, the first edition of the reborn Rugby League Fanfare. Yes, I say reborn because a Rugby League Fanfare and the International Rugby League Supporters Federation have a long history. The organisation was originally started back in April 1979 by Bob Brown. Back then, Rugby League Fanfare was a monthly newsletter which Bob Brown edited. Well, now we hope to bring you a monthly podcast with information about everything that's going on in International Rugby League. Of course, back in 1979, there were only five nations playing Rugby League. Well, now there's more than 60 nations playing the game of Rugby League. That's right, more than 60. So you might say there's been a revolution in International Rugby League, and we want you to join the revolution. So if you go to our website, www.rlfanfare.com, rlfanfare.com, you'll see that there's a Join Us page. So just log in, and for $10 you can be Join the Revolution. Unfortunately, one of the reasons that the IRLSF disappeared in the 80s was through a lack of funds, and we don't want that to happen again. During our initial incarnation, the International Rugby League Supporters Federation, well, we supported rugby league in the United States, Fiji. We also started a Club of the Year award for all those rugby league clubs competing in the, let's call them the minor rugby league states here in Australia. The Canberra Gallopers were the initial winners of the Club of the Year award from the International Rugby League Supporters Federation. So please, help us develop the game of rugby league. And as I said, join the revolution. www.rlfanfare.com and go to the Join Us page. Now, as you're all aware, the 2022 Rugby League World Cup beckons. And one of the most amazing stories of this competition comes from Brazil. Earlier this week, I spoke to Robert Bergen to find out what's going on. Well, the girls from Ipanema are not wearing bikinis. They're not even wearing Pelé's famous number 10 jersey. No, the girls from Ipanema are wearing rugby league jerseys. Brazil have qualified for the 2022 Women's Rugby League World Cup. Who better to talk to about this amazing achievement than Robert Bergen, who's the manager of the Brazilian team, also co-convener of the Latin Heat Rugby League. So, Robert, welcome to Rugby League Fanfare.
Thanks a lot for having me. That's one of the best introductions I've ever had.
Okay. Robert, before we talk about the World Cup, I was hoping you could tell us a bit about rugby league in Brazil. I mean, when and how did this all get started? What sort of competitions are operating in Brazil?
Sure. So rugby league really got kicked off here in about 2013. There'd been some small competitions before that, but 2013 they started free-to-air of NRL here.
Yes.
And during that period, it actually received the sixth highest audience in the world for the NRL Grand Final in 2013, which was the Roosters versus Manly. And, of course, it was a pretty exciting game.
Yeah.
The other thing that tied in really nicely to that was Sonny Bill Williams played in that game. And a lot of people in South America who've never heard of either rugby code have still heard of Sonny Bill Williams because of his, I guess, his celebrity.
Yes.
It kind of, that really gave it the push. So the funny thing is that in many ways, because Sonny Bill had played rugby union before, it helped launch rugby league over here. And a fellow called Hugo Froes, who's from a small Ish town in the mountains here in Minas Gerais. He saw it and wanted to bring all the people that were interested in rugby league together around the country. He got it rolling. Brazil started to compete against Argentina, against Chile, etc. At the moment, we've got men's and women's national competitions. We are starting a wheelchair competition. We've had some youth competitions. So really, we're trying to do the full gamut and reach that level of full membership of the IRL, not just play, you know, men's or small amount of game of women's.
Yeah, I mean, how many teams are we talking about? Okay, in the men and women's competitions, how many teams have we got?
You're looking at six for both. So this year we've had to split into an A and a B division. We were last year we had more teams. We had seven men, eight women, but we were finding that the lower teams were, you know, they were traveling very long distances here just to get beaten by a big margin. So that was hard to sustain. I would say from my experiences being here the last few months that we're going to have more men's teams at least next year.
Yes.
I've been running clinics at new clubs that want to learn the sport and want to join in. They've heard about it. So I believe next year we're going to see some good growth in the men's in some key areas.
Because I imagine, you know, Brazil's a fairly big country. So like the tyranny of distance must play a part in these competitions, mate. Have you got sort of like, I don't know, North and South conferences or West and East conferences or something?
We haven't at the moment, but that's definitely something that's on the table for next year. It's just been hard with so many, with so little teams, I guess, to start off, you know, with around that six mark to split it into geographical. Because let's say, for instance, our three strongest clubs here really are probably our furthest north club, our furthest west club, and our furthest east club. So if we did it by regions, then a couple of clubs would end up beating everyone substantially.
All right. So and how did Brazil qualify for the World Cup? So you were saying earlier there is competition, there is international competition, at least at the men's level between various South American countries. I know that because there's been international tournaments. Chile's been involved, and Brazil, Ecuador, and so forth. Is it the same for the women?
No. So to go back, the women they played against Argentina in 2018, and that was part of the South American Championships at the time. We usually have three to four men's teams in the South American Championship.
Yes.
That year there was only two in the women, but Argentina had been undefeated before, so it was a big surprise when Brazil beat them 48-0, and that kind of goes to show the level of seriousness with which they approached it, and then the subsequent application or, argument to have us included in the World Cup was because of that build-up and the professionalism of people like Hugo.
And what about, for future World Cups? Is this a one-off sort of situation for the South Americans, or what about qualification for future World Cups? Is it going to be sort of like I suppose you call it a South American zone or something for qualification for future World Cups?
Yeah, I think we'll see that, and probably an America's zone as such. So for 2025 in France, Brazil is already qualified for that as well by virtue of playing in this this year's tournament. And that's because they're going to double the number of women's teams from 8 to 16. So they're taking every team that's playing in this year's World Cup. And then for down the track, we know that we're looking at three qualifiers from within North America and South America. So, you know, Brazil at the moment, I would say in females is comfortably ahead of the others. But then you've got other teams like Canada, Jamaica, USA, that also have women's teams are very, very keen. Canada's at this year's World Cup. America's just starting out in women's league, but they've shown some very good promise.
Yes, yeah, all right. All right, well, also, I'm very interested in the players in this Brazilian team, Robert. Obviously, they're not professional, so can you give us a bit of background on some of the players in this team? You know, what do they do? How did they get involved in rugby league? How did their interest in rugby league start?
Well, that's probably one thing that that is a surprise to talk about to start is that we do actually have one professional team here. So the northernmost team, Molina, which is in a town called Coia or city called Cuiabá, which is near the Amazon, they actually live in a compound, and the owner of the club he's a French millionaire.
Right.
They live in their compound. They have a 100-meter walk to the gym, to the pool. They have physio. They've got fields that are better than most you'd find anywhere in the world. And so they're in a very lucky and unique position. Certainly that's not replicated across Brazil, but it is quite a bit of a curiosity that probably half of our team for the World Cup will come from Molina, where the girls are professional.
Okay.
And another little curiosity about that is the name of the street they live on is Ayrton Senna Boulevard.
Okay.
So everybody tends to know Ayrton Senna when you talk about him.
Yes.
We do have a lot of university-educated girls within the system, which is, it's quite refreshing. The girls, a lot of them are doing quite big things with their careers. We've got one girl who is a professor of chemistry.
Right.
We have another who is a professor of physical education development, and she's written like 9 research papers. She actually speaks at international councils on how to develop sport within communities, especially women's sports. So some really interesting characters. The one that's a professor of chemistry, she's also a Brazilian jiu-jitsu champion.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Because was there, I'm sort of thinking, are there rugby sort of offshoots here? Is rugby played, rugby union I'm talking about, played in Brazil? Are these players, some of these players played other sports and they've come across to rugby league?
Yeah, quite a few are from rugby union. Rugby union has a really long history here in Brazil. I believe that they might have even started playing here before Australia, but certainly was the end of the 1800s. There were already clubs starting out in Brazil from English merchants, etc. And so we do have quite a few from union that have come over. Union here really, it existed but wasn't big until about 15 years ago, and then it's really grown over that time. The other background we tend to get a lot of people from is we get people from basketball, handball, and martial arts tend to be the other sports we're finding a lot of crossover from.
Yeah, okay. Okay, so you talked about university-educated players. I mean, are there other players from sort of like, let's say, lower socioeconomic areas?
Definitely, and that's a big challenge. We had some twins that were in our World Cup squad. They won't, unfortunately, be in our final World Cup squad, but they were in the extended group. And these girls were from a family where there was a single mother with 12 kids. They didn't have food and, the milk, et cetera, in their house. And their coach was actually buying them food after training every day. So... it's a really good story about how the support from within the sport has helped people improve their lives. Those two girls are actually they're on a scholarship now. Then they're going to Sao Paulo, so they've moved away from the smaller town and into the bigger city. So there's a pathway for them to do bigger things with their lives.
All right, I just want to go back for a second. Sorry, Robert. I just want to go back, and you were talking there about the. People from a university background being involved in the game. Are the universities a possible sort of growth for rugby league? I mean, could you see rugby league teams are starting in some of the universities over there?
Yeah, I think so. The only curiosity with universities here is that a lot of them don't have any sports fields. They don't, they're just buildings. They don't actually have any fields to play on, which is a little bit of a drawback. I think a real opportunity here is with the military.
Yes.
A lot of people go into military or police. So there's like, there's many levels of police here. And a lot of them are, you know, they're based in a campus and they've got training facilities, et cetera. And they want people to exhibit the same sort of qualities we have in rugby league. So I believe there's opportunities there. We've had a few discussions and that'll continue.
All right. So the players, well, the players have had to overcome a lot of hurdles to get here. But I'm just wondering about you yourself as the manager of the team. There must have been, tremendous hurdles in putting this team together. For example, you know, well, for a start, we've heard about that the COVID pandemic has been very bad in Brazil. So you must have to overcome a lot of hurdles, mate, to get to this. Well, we're not at the World Cup yet. We're almost there. But how difficult has it been for you and the management team to get this team ready for this World Cup?
There's a book in it at some stage, I think. But,
I imagine there's,
it's the challenges have come in different phases and different guises. I think early on, our biggest challenge was that a lot of people didn't even believe that we were playing rugby league here. And, I'm talking about some of the very top people within international rugby league were sort of very sceptical about what we were doing. And I think as time's gone by, it's been nice to see that attitude change. We're receiving a lot of support and encouragement from the wider rugby league community now. So that fight for recognition and for acceptance was really probably the first fight. And you've mentioned geography. We're a country in Brazil that's bigger than Australia. Our population is more decentralized, so it's spread out all across the country, which means every time we have a national camp or a game, we're flying in people from all over the place. And, you know, the average wage or minimum wage here is the equivalent of about $60 a week. But domestic air flights are not really any cheaper than Australia. In fact, in many cases, they're more expensive. So people save up for months and months to be able to afford their flights. And that's huge, because then we can't reasonably expect the players to dip into their own pocket.
No.
We have to go out and source funding to make those travels and camps possible. Otherwise, we don't prepare adequately for what's in front of us. So, that's a huge challenge. The other one, I guess, when we're trying to attract funding, is that people in Australia know the value of the sport, but they don't recognize the people from Brazil or the value of advertising in Brazil. And the same with England, you know, that's where the money is, that's where the understanding of rugby league is. And then when we go to people with inside Brazil, it's such a football mad country that people kind of look at you and think, you know, what's the value in me getting involved in rugby league? Is anyone going to hear about it? They don't understand how massive it is outside. You know, I tell people here, 1 in 4 Australians will watch the World Cup. There's a social media audience of about 300 million people predicted for the World Cup, but they're used to seeing, you know, a couple of dozen people at the field. So for them, it's a different world, you know. That's really hard to sell to sponsors.
Well, I mean, okay, so there have been a lot of problems you've had to overcome, but there's also been a few encouraging things. There's been a lot of support for this Brazilian team, and you've got support from all sorts of places, but one of the most interesting supporters I found is the London City Lionesses. What can you tell us about the London City Lionesses?
Mate, well, they actually defaulted on their sponsorship.
Oh, did they?
No, that's fine. We have a new major sponsor, Stake, which have been fantastic supporters, and in fact supported us a lot more than London City Lionesses were. So that's great. But we're trying to forge linkages with football. Obviously, here is a football mad country, so yep. It makes sense for us to ride on board that train as well.
Okay, what about Agrimix Pastures? Are they still involved?
Yeah, definitely. So they came on board because their chief scientist was actually a Brazilian agronomist, another scientist actually. He's sort of a master's in agronomical science. And he came to Australia and he became fascinated with Jonathan Thurston and the Cowboys. So he talked to his bosses and said, you know, we need to get behind this. Brazil's doing great things. And yeah, his story in itself is very motivating because he's from quite a faraway town in Brazil. And he used to sell like water at the lights to be able to afford his bus tickets to get to games. And now here he is helping a team go to a World Cup. So that just shows you that what can come from a perseverance and passion.
All right. And also the jerseys that the Brazilian team will be wearing. There's some big names behind that. And thankfully, it does look like it's a great looking jersey. It's a traditional looking jersey. You know, it's not a combination of sort of swirls and stripes and fading colours, which we get a lot on these days. But what about the jersey you'll be wearing?
Yeah, so we have a partnership with Petro Sivanasiva Sports, which is also known as Pacific Custom Sportswear. They'll be our supplier. And there's a bit of a nice story behind that as well. Myself and Petro, we actually went to the same primary school. He was a couple of years older than me. And then we worked together at the Brisbane Broncos for a little while when I was in the media team there and he was kind of just starting out. So, that's nice that we've been able to continue that. Everyone knows what a trustworthy and genuine person that Petro Sivanasiva is. So it's good to have a relationship with a business like that because, I know that a lot of things can go wrong in the uniform game. So you need to be working with people that you trust.
And the uniforms are available. People could get themselves a uniform or those caps and scarves and all that sort of thing as well. There's a site there, isn't it, loxtonberg.com. I mean, can you log on now and get a hold of a Brazilian jersey?
Yeah, for sure. We've got our yellow main jersey, our white alternative jersey. Caps and beanies. We'll be adding some other bits and pieces like tracksuit pants, etc. But if anyone struggles to find the website, it's www.loxtonberg.com.
Yes, we'll put that address up on our website when the show goes up on the site. So listen, Robert, of course, this tournament was supposed to take place last year, but it was postponed for various reasons, and I'm imagining that for the Brazilian Rugby League, this would have been a huge pain in the ass. Actually, I mean, from an organisational point of view, it was. I imagine this has caused all sorts of problems for you. The postponement.
Yeah, I mean, first up, your sponsors—they've committed X amount of money because they know you're going to a worldwide tournament, but they don't want to be continuing that support over 2 years, so to go to them and ask for more money, is not always possible. So we've had to really stretch one budget over 2 years, and I've already spoken about some of the challenges we have with budget here. So that has been massive. A lot of us who are staff, all of us who are staff are volunteers. And we've traveled to, all the camps and events and back and forwards across the world many times to make this all happen. And that's come out of our own pockets. When the World Cup was cancelled last year, we'd been told only a few days beforehand to book all of our flights and accommodation for our last camp. And we did so. And then within a couple of days, it was cancelled. So we lost a fair bit of money on that because of non-refundable aspects. And, we're not rich people to start with. So, it's been a challenge, but we move forward. And what John Dutton, the CEO says is, of World Cup says is quite correct in that we're going to be playing before packed stadiums. There's going to be more community interaction. There's going to be more of the top players there this year. So we've had some pain, but, you know, let's be positive now.
Okay. Well, yes. Well, that's what I wanted to. I just wanted to finish up by asking you what do you think this World Cup is going to do for rugby league in Brazil?
Yeah, I think as long as we capitalise in the right ways, you know, like at the moment, I'm having some discussions because we've introduced the World Cup to a few different people in the broadcast game over here in Brazil. And one of the things we struggle with is that previously, as I said to you, in 2013, it was on free-to-air here. Now you can't even get it unless you get the NRL app. It's not broadcast on TV at all. What we've seen is that American football has really overtaken. American football is here all over the place. If you go to a bar or a cafe and everyone has a American football team, when I try to explain to them what rugby league or even rugby union is, we have to say it's a type of American football or otherwise people just don't get it.
Right.
And so I think broadcast is a big challenge. So I hope that in the remaining weeks that the Rugby League World Cup goes all out to get a broadcast deal for this part of the world, whether it's a continuation with Fox Sports or they can tap into one of the local broadcasters here. It's a huge opportunity and we can't let it slip by. So I see potential for massive growth, but it has to be done the right way.
All right, Robert, thanks very much for your time and best of luck for the girls from Ipanema.
Awesome. Thank you.
Okay, thank you again to Robert Bergen for filling us in on that amazing story about the Brazilian women's rugby league team, and very good to hear that the international board plans to increase the number of teams in the Women's World Cup to be held in France in 2025. Now, lastly, we're going to have a segment on Rugby League Fanfare every month, or we're hoping to do it every month, called Rugby League World. And in Rugby League World, we're going to introduce to you, our listeners, some of the many places around the world where rugby league is played. So in this, our first edition of Rugby League World, we're going to take you to the Great Rift Valley in East Africa. We're going to a country called Burundi. Burundi is a very small landlocked country. One of its borders is Lake Tanganyika. But it's a country, well, in area, its total is only 27,800 square kilometres. So it's about a third the size of Tasmania. The country is independent. But it was a former colony of Germany and was governed by Belgium for a very lengthy period up until 1962. The country has had its problems. There have been some terrible civil wars, and recently the COVID pandemic had a severe impact on the country. But despite all this, rugby league is alive in Burundi. And that's thanks to a fellow called Jean du Christ Ruziga. Because in 2015, Jean started the Burundi Rugby League Association. Now, the primary objectives of the Burundi Rugby League are to improve the nutrition of participants, to provide drug education programs to the participants, and to improve the overall welfare of the players in the Burundi Rugby League. Now, the first club to be formed in Burundi, let's say the new town of Burundi, was the Kinedo Impala. And the Impalas went on to win the first grand final back in 2016. The structure of the Burundi Rugby League is that they have a number of rugby league associations. You might call them clubs. These associations are affiliated to the Birundo Rugby League. Now, at the moment, there are 9 rugby league associations in the Burundi Rugby League. One of the criteria for membership of the Burundi Rugby League is that every association or club must have 2 men's teams and 2 women's teams. Now, that criteria, well, is not always possible, of course. For example, the university club has only 3 teams, and the Northern Eagles club, yes, the Northern Eagles. You know, some of you here in Australia probably think the Northern Eagles were dead and buried. No, the Northern Eagles are alive in Burundi. The Kayanza Rugby League, the Kayanza Northern Eagles have 2 teams in the Burundi Rugby League Association. Then you have a Karuzi Rugby League, which has, they actually have 2 clubs. They have the Rams and the Tigers, so they have 8 teams. So the number of teams varies between the various associations. Now, the competition itself, well, there is obviously a premiership, the 13-a-side premiership. The current men's premiers are the Rams, and in the women's, the Gatiga Gorillas are the premiers. There's also a 9s tournament and a challenge cup or a knockout competition, but unfortunately these competitions are not always held because of, well, just basically a lack of funds or simply a lack of personnel to coordinate the different federations. There hasn't been much chance of international rugby league for Burundi because of the COVID pandemic. But the Wild Goats, yes, the national team, the Burundi Wild Goats, did play an international against one of their neighbours, the Democratic Republic of Congo, back in 2018. The Lake Tanganyika Challenge, and that match ended in a 4-all draw. Burundi has been trying to get the status of an affiliate member with the European Rugby League, but it hasn't happened. From what I've been told, all the required documentation has been supplied, but they still don't have the status of affiliate member. Now, this is where the International Rugby League Supporters Federation becomes involved. The Burundi Rugby League needs some help. Burundi is a very poor nation. The COVID pandemic has had, a huge impact on the country and its people. The people participating in rugby league tend to come from, let's say, the lower socioeconomic levels. But rugby league has given the people a sense of community and cooperation during these very difficult times. Now, Jean and his supporters at the Burundi Rugby League need a lot of help. Now, I noticed amongst all the photos that Jean sent me, there were some photos, some of the players were wearing the Swinton Lions jersey. Swinton, they're down in the lower divisions of the English Rugby League these days, but they've obviously donated some of their old jerseys to the Burundi Rugby League. I know from one of the articles he sent me that Tasbayatiri organised some referee coaching classes through the French Rugby League. So, here on Rugby League Fanfare, we're putting out, I suppose, a public appeal for help. If you, or perhaps someone you know, has access to anything involved in the playing of rugby league, it might be some footballs, it might be some old jerseys. Whatever happened to those old Northern Eagles jerseys? They're probably lying around in someone's garage. any rugby league equipment at all is going to be very much appreciated by the Burundi Rugby League. Excuse me. Excuse me again. Now, if you go to our website, www.rlfanfare.com, www.rlfanfare.com, you'll see that we have some email addresses for Jean. There's also a Facebook site address. Or you could just send us an email. You know, send an email to the IRLSF at thegreatestgameofall@hotmail.com. Thegreatestgameofall@hotmail.com. Let's help Jean and the people at the Burundi Rugby League keep rugby league going in Burundi. And thank you very much to our African correspondent, Michael Borg, for supplying the information for this segment. That's about all we have time for you, ladies and gentlemen. We hope you've enjoyed the show. In the meantime, you've been listening to Rugby League Fanfare, brought to you by the International Rugby League Supporters Federation. My name's Rob Corra. On behalf of President Bob Brown, this program was recorded in the studios of Undercover Music. Your producer is Renata Jimenez. Until next month, may the force be with you.
And when she passes, each one she passes goes, ah. When she walks, she's like a samba that swings so cool and sways so gentle that when she passes, each one she passes goes, ooh. But I watch her so sadly. How can I tell her I love her? Yes, I would give my heart gladly. But each day when she walks to the sea, she looks straight ahead, not at me. Tall and tan and young and lovely, the girl from Ipanema goes walking, and when she passes, I smile, but she doesn't see, doesn't see.
Olha que coisa mais linda, mais cheia de graça, bela menina que vem, que passa, num doce balanço, caminho do mar. Moça do corpo dourado, do sol de Ipanema, o seu balançado parece um poema, é a coisa mais linda que eu já vi passar.
Ooh, but I watch her so sadly.
Ah, porque tudo é tão triste.
Yes, I would give my heart gladly. But each day when she walks to the sea, she looks straight ahead, not at me. Tall, tan, young, lovely, the girl from Ipanema goes walking, and when she passes, I smile, but she doesn't see.
Por causa do amor,
she just doesn't see. She never sees me.
Por causa do amor.
Ding, ding, ding.